you very much, Frédéric. I would like, of course, to thank the organizer. It's a pleasure to be back in this wonderful conference. So I will try to cover many aspects of optimal transport, mostly from a computational perspective. I will insist a bit on recent algorithms, and in particular this idea we are using a lot of Schrödinger, I would say, anthropic regularization, to draw some link, of course, with geometry of information through unbalanced optimal transport, and show some more, I would say, high-dimensional and prospective application to machine learning, which will be the last part of this talk. I'd like also to say that it's a joint work with a lot of people, in particular with Marco Cuturi, who is the one that promoted a lot this idea of anthropic regularization. Also with François-Xavier Viala, who is one of my long-standing collaborators, especially on the aspect of geometry. And also many of the results are in the PhD thesis of Haute-Genevet, so, who finished their PhD very recently. Okay, so let's, and also before I begin, some shameless advertisement for this book we've written with Marco, which covers most of the topics I will speak about today. So if you want more details, this is a free PDF that you can download online. All right, so before starting, let's try to motivate a bit so why we want to go to this idea of geometry for distribution, optimal transport, of course, but more generally, introducing distance that take into account the geometry. I would say first because many problems ranging from signal processing, image processing, data science, and more machine learning, they require you to handle distribution of points, distribution of mass, density that you want to compare. And this is just a few representative examples. For instance, in imaging science, you extract some feature from the data and you compare their distribution. It's a very simple approach, but that is remarkably efficient. The most simple example, you just take the color of an image, it gives you some kind of color palette, and you want to compare these color palettes together. It's an application more in computational neuroscience where you want to handle the geometry of the activity on the cortex, which could of course be also dynamics, and you view this as some kind of distribution of mass. One of the iconic applications of, I would say, matching registration is in computational anatomy, where you want to compare various shapes, register shapes, can be volumes, can be surface, and so on. And of course, you want to compare them in a geometrically faithful way, and I would say it's one of the most important applications of this idea of geometric matching. And these two ones are more, I would say, machine learning type application. The first one is in natural language processing, where you want to compare to the translation, text, a corpus of documents. And one of the key revolutions in NLP these last few years is this idea of replacing words by vectors, typically, to do vector calculus to obtain state-of-the-art results in probably every task nowadays regarding NLP. So it's really a game changer in the field. And here, once again, you can view collection of text, collection of text as a set of points, which would be the word, the sentence, and so on, in a high-dimensional space, okay? And you want to compare them or to do clustering and so on. And the last aspect is more in computer vision and computer graphics is the idea of representing lot of images, basically, or videos. So you have to analyze the geometry of the distribution of millions of images viewed as some kind of distribution of points. For instance, in order to do generation of new images, special effects, and so on. It's very trendy, and there's a lot of work, of course, related to neural networks, and more recently, adversarial neural networks, where you introduce pairs of neural nets to handle this geometry. All right, so how do you do this, and what kind of problem you'd like to address? I would say most of the problem you would be facing resolve around this idea of having a parametric model or some kind of understanding of the data. So you can say my data is a set of points, beta, so a discrete distribution if you want, and you want to model them using a parametric model. Of course, if it's a Gaussian, theta would be the mean and the covariance, and you don't need optimal transport, it's obvious. But the idea is how can you modify theta in order for this model to become as close as possible from the input? Can do this as kind of parameter estimation, density fitting, parametric modeling, thin shapes. It's kind of a universal problem. And of course, the key aspect here is what kind of discrepancy, capital D, you want to use in order to compare to distribution. Probably one of the main topics of this conference. And today, the idea I would like to insist on is this idea of optimal transport, which you can view as a machinery, a method, to lift some distance between points. So in all these applications, the data is not like an abstract set of points, it really lives in some kind of of metric space, could be the space of colors, for instance, the geodesics on the surface, kind of word to vec representation to compare vectors and so on. And how do you lift this small d between points to capital D between group of points, group of mass or density? An optimal transport is in some way a canonical way to do this using mathematics and optimization. Okay. And the question is, how do you do this also in practice using algorithm? Okay, so let's be a bit more precise, and probably most of you know this already, but I'd like to settle the notation, explain a bit the history. I would say the true revolution in optimal transport, which was introduced by Monge, is this idea of Kantorovich, of introducing some kind of a relaxation. So I would start by this. So in the 40s, the description of Kantorovich of modern optimal transport. What is the question you want to address? You want to compare a group of points, so density if you want. In the discrete settings, what is it? It's just point location, so the xi here, and weights. The weight should be positive. And in the most application, and in my talk, most of my talk, I will assume everything is normalized, so you have probability distribution. Okay? And the genius of Kantorovich is to describe the movement of mass using what is called a coupling or also a transport plan, which is basically a 2D matrix, or in probability it would be a joint distribution of values. So what is capital P? It's just a bunch of positive number. And each time you have a non-zero element in this matrix, it means you will transfer some mass from the red to the blue. So you see in the first line here, you have a single non-zero element. It means that all the mass from the first red point here gets mapped to the first blue point. Kind of a deterministic transfer of mass between one point and one other. But really, the groundbreaking idea is that sometimes you can and you need to split the mass. And this is what allows Kantorovich to do. For instance, on the second line, this mass gets split in two and mapped to two points. And really, it's why he got the Nobel Prize in economics. It was introduced for application in economics, but of course, after it, it has a much wider set of applications. That you can somehow, at some point, have some production you want to split and to send at two set of points. And the only constraint you need to satisfy, but it's very important, is that, of course, it should be positive, and it should satisfy the conservation of mass, which is basically just the fact that the sum along the line should be equal to A, and the sum along the rows should be equal to B. So all the mass from A gets transported to B. And this is fairly simple because it's just affine constraints. In terms of matrix, it's matrix P times vector 1 should be equal to A, sum on the line, and the transpose of P times 1 should be equal to B. So it describes the set of allowable movement of mass in a convex way. This is just a gigantic polytope described by positivity and affine constraints. And among all these possible strategy, optimal transport consists in minimizing some costs. So you decide what is the cost you pay when you transfer a single amount of mass. And the usual choice is to say it's going to be the power P of the distance. Okay? So P equal 1 would be the classical choice made by Monge, but you can select any P you want. Many mathematicians select P equal 2 because it comes with a lot of nice mathematical properties. But okay, it's up to your application to select which P you want or which metric you want to use. And why is it so nice, and what basically does it get the Nobel Prize? It's because it's just linear programming. It's a linear function under linear affine constraints. So it's also the birth of linear programming. And it goes together with the second revolution led by George Danzig of the introduction of the simplex algorithm. Because I guess if there was no algorithm to solve this, it would never get the Nobel Prize. So it's because George Danzig invented the simplex algorithm that people realized that it was super powerful to model economic behavior. Of course, now what we want to do is to apply this more to data science, but everything comes from simplex, basically. Simplex and this very nice modeling of Kantorovich. All right, so it's a linear programming, it's super simple, but at the same time, if the dimension is very huge, and it's also in high dimension, it starts to be very challenging. So what are the different options we have? I will describe this in more details, but okay, my talk is basically just about linear programming. So I will not insist on this, but everything that would stay extend to arbitrary densities, simply replace sum by integrals. I will describe everything with discrete points, but believe me, there's no problem in extending everything to arbitrary Hadron measure. Although, of course, on a computer, most of the time you will discretize your data. So why is it so important? Why do we care about this optimal transport? Well, it's important because it gives you access to a transport, but what is even more important is the value of this minimum. Because the value of this minimum, when you take the power 1 over p, it's defined what is often called the Wasserstein distance or the Monge-Kantorovich distance, which is a distance, which is not so trivial from the definition, but it's true. So it satisfies the triangular inequality, and it's zero if and only if alpha equals beta. But okay, why would you want to use this one instead of a more classical distance, like the total variation, or maybe any other reasonable distance? It's because it's a geometric distance. It's a geometric distance whose topology is the geometric topology, if you want, what probabilists would call the topology of the convergence in law, and maybe analysts would call it the weak star convergence. Okay, what does it mean? It means the topology of the Wasserstein distance is the topology where densities go to zero, where the points move together. So in terms of mathematics, it's just that some densities or some distribution converge in law to another one, if and only if its expectation converges. So you need to do some kind of local averaging to see the convergence. And I would say an even simpler way to look at this convergence is to look at the convergence of a single Dirac. It's obvious, but then once you have understood what happened with one Dirac, you also understand what happened with more. So what does it mean that a single Dirac converges to another one? Since you test against continuous function, it simply means that actually the location of the Dirac converges. It's probably the most simple, intuitive way to say a Dirac converges to another one. And this is convergence in law. And I'd like to contrast this with a strong topology, the topology of the L1 norm, if you want, or the total variation. So what is it? It's just computing the difference between the two, and you take the total mass of the difference. But what is the problem? Is if you use this topology, when you have two Dirac that are not at the same location, their respective norm is just 2, because it's minus 1 and plus 1. So it means for the strong topology, a Dirac never converges to another one, okay, unless they are equal. As a sharp contrast, the Wasserstein distance between two Dirac is simply the distance between the points. So you see, it really metrizes in a perfect way, and you can show actually it's the only distance that has this nice property, the convergence of the points, and then transfer it to the convergence of a group of points. Okay. So it's really the natural way to quantify convergence in law. It's why Wasserstein distance is used a lot by probabilists to have quantitative statements about convergence in law. The most iconic theorem is the central limit theorem that you can study using Wasserstein distance. It's not the purpose of my talk. My talk is to use this in a practical way to do computation, to register shapes, to do machine learning. But the underlying message is this is the natural way to quantify that object densities are close together in a geometrical way, which would not be possible with a stronger norm, like the total variation norm. All right? Okay, now the big question I would say is how do you compute it? Well, the simplest way is just to run simplex algorithm whose complexity is basically n cubed log n for this problem. So it's actually fairly efficient. And it works great up to, I would say, maybe 10,000 points. It's probably the method of choice because it makes no error. It computes with precision, with error zero, the optimal transport. But of course, if n is of the order of millions, and if you have also lots of optimal transport to compute at the same time, it's become impracticable. You cannot use it. So you need to use simpler algorithm that might not be as accurate, but that would be much faster. What are the other options? If you have the, let's say, standard case where there's uniform distribution, so empirical densities, it's just two group of points, and then there is a celebrated theorem by Birkhoff and von Neumann that says that the optimal transport between two set of points of the same size is actually the optimal matching, so it's a bijection. So you can use algorithm from optimal matching, from combinatorial optimization to solve this more efficiently, although it's still n-cubed. And the two most well-known algorithms is the Hungarian algorithm and the auction algorithm of Bert Szekas that probably you know. They are really like amazing algorithms, gems from combinatorial optimization that I guess everybody should know. It's a very important algorithm. There is one case which is trivial, in which case you don't really need to attend my talk. It's if the data is 1D. If the data is 1D, the optimal transport is monotonic, is increasing, which means that you solve it by simply ordering the point from left to right. And you will match the first blue point here to the first red point and so on, which means that in 1D, the complexity of optimal transport is n log n. So it's fairly simple. And the algorithm is just quick sort, so it's really efficient. But OK, unfortunately, it's probably never the case that you have just 1D data. I'd like to point a few other cases where things are really well understood and efficient. The other also very nice case, although it's not nice from a mathematical perspective, but from a computational perspective, the case P equal 1 with, for instance, the Euclidean norm, which was the case considered by Monge, can be recast as a mean cost flow problem, and which means you can actually solve it much more efficiently, for instance, if the data is on a graph. You typically have complexity, rather of complexity n squared if you have a sparse graph. So So in this case, having a mean cost flow is really a game changer, and it's much faster. Another case that has been also studied a lot by theorists and also people from PDEs and numerical analysis is the case P equal 2 on the Euclidean space, in which case optimal transport can be recast as solving a PDE. In static form, it's going to be what is called the Monge-Ampère equation, which is kind of a nasty Poisson equation, so it's not so trivial to solve. And it's the dynamic case is going to be the celebrated Benamou-Brogniet equation to solve. And this is basically the geodesic between here it's Yann Brogniet, and here is Benamou, Jean-David Benamou. So here black means lot of mass. So it has absolutely no physical meaning, it's just for fun, because you see it gives kind of crazy, weird interpolation. So optimal transport is not here to do nice interpolation of faces, but it's fun, and it's solved by a classical PDE method. So in 2D and 3D, it's fairly efficient, and you can solve it using finite element or finite differences. There is one case also where you have efficient solver. It's the same case as before, square cost. But when you want to map a sparse set of points toward a continuum of mass, in this case, the optimal transport will basically segment the space in little cells, and each cell would be mapped to a single point. And you can easily show that these cells, they are basically Voronoi partition, generalized Voronoi partition. So then you have a lot of algorithms, several algorithms that have been developed that leverage the fact that in 2D and 3D, it's very simple and efficient to compute Voronoi partition with using tools from computational geometry. For instance, Quentin Mérigo and Bruno Lévy at INRIA, they have worked a lot recently on having state-of-the-art implementation for this kind of tools, which are state-of-the-art in 2D and 3D. Okay. Now, what do you do when you have a generic cost? And also, I would say even more, what do you do if you're in high dimension, where it's pretty hopeless, and I will explain this, to try to compute with a lot of precision the optimal transport. What you would do, what you would like, is maybe some kind of approximate algorithm that don't do a very good job if you want high precision, but that is super simple and super efficient when you want low precision. And this is what we'll introduce now, using a very simple idea, using this idea of anthropic regularization. Okay? And I know several people in the room are actually experts on this. There's a lot of nice mathematics around this, but today, I will really focus my attention on the algorithm. All right. So just to say a bit of history, this is an idea that you can trace back all the way to Schrödinger because it's related to models in the dynamics of gas, the lazy gas model. And I'm not an expert, I will not explain about this. Here I'm really motivated rather by the computational aspect and also the fact that this allows you to go to higher dimension. The idea is very simple, just take the classical optimal transport formula and you penalize the entropy of the coupling. Okay, so here it's going to be minus the entropy, so you want an optimal transport plan that has a bit more entropy than the classical optimal transport, a little bit diffuse if you want. You introduce some diffusion, and epsilon is kind of a temperature that will make the plan a little bit more diffuse, and it makes the optimization problem much more simple. Okay, and just a little detail here, and it's fairly important for the theory, I use the relative entropy between the coupling and the natural measure associated to my problem, which is basically the product of the input, okay, which is given by the problem. So we are very lucky in optimal transport because there is natural reference measure to regularize. All right. So this is a convex, actually strictly convex problem. So it has a single solution, so it's better than optimal transport, simpler, I would say. And the effect is diffusion. So if you look at the optimal matching problem of points, when you introduce a bit of epsilon, it diffuses a bit the matching. And instead of having a one-to-one match, you become to have more and more links, if you want, between the points. So it will make the solution much more stable and robust in high dimension. This would be a very important effect for later. And as epsilon goes to infinity, you have more and more connection. And at the end, when epsilon is large, and I will explain this later, it becomes a very simple model where everybody is linked to everybody. So optimal transport, Schrödinger, will also be the way to link two extremal situations that are very important. Right. Here on the very different case of having 1D densities, two mixture of Gaussian, then it's also a celebrated theorem. It's the continuous version, if you want, of Birkhoff-von Neumann theorem. It's a theorem by Yann Brogniet in 91, who proves that the optimal transport between two densities, continuous densities, is located on a graph of a function of the Monge map. So you see it's very, very sparse. And as epsilon increases, you'd have some diffusion, or in image processing, it would be some kind of denoising or blurring that makes, if you want, the solution a bit more blurry, a bit more fat, if you want, around the. And in the extreme case, if epsilon goes to infinity, this is nothing more than, if you want, the mutual information. So as epsilon goes to infinity, the coupling is just the trivial one, A times B. So you have a totally diffuse extremal case. Totally, is as if you treat these two, blue and red, as being independent. So you see epsilon is a way to interpolate between total dependency, one is the function of the other along a 1D curve, and total independency, where everybody is independent. So it has a lot of equivalent, interesting explanation for the same phenomena of diffusion. Okay, so this is nice, but how do you compute it? And you see it's actually surprisingly simple. It's much simpler than simplex algorithm. I would say, as with any optimization problem, what you start is by looking at the optimality condition, or the dual problem for those who do convex analysis, but it's exactly the same. So here you have two constraints, the constraint on the row and the columns. So you introduce two sets of Lagrange multipliers, and you look at what's happened, and I tell you the answer, but it's actually fairly simple to prove, is that capital P would be a solution if and only if it satisfies the conservation of mass, and it can be factorized using a Gibbs kernel. Because my Schrödinger problem is just a maximum entropy method. It's going to be factorized through a Gibbs kernel. What is a Gibbs kernel? For those who know kernels, they would not be surprised. It's the exponential of minus the cost divided by epsilon. So if you think about the classical case of the square of the Euclidean distance, this guy is just a gigantic Gaussian matrix, Gaussian kernels. And you need to factorize it by multiplying the row by some scalar ui, and the column by some scalar vj, which is often called a diagonal factorization. It means your matrix P, you wrote it as a multiplication of a diagonal matrix U times a kernel times a diagonal matrix V. And now the question becomes, how do you compute U and V? So you see, instead of looking for N times M numbers, so a big matrix, now I only have to take care of two sets of numbers, two vectors. So it's a bit more simpler computationally, I would say. But still, it raises the question, how do you compute these two guys together? Right? How do you do this? You simply write the conservation of mass, and they become surprisingly simple. If you multiply this matrix by one, you obtain a simple equation, which is this one. It's U multiply, so this means multiplication entry-wise. In Python, it's just multiplication. Multiply by the vector K times V. This is a matrix, and this is a vector. And this guy should be equal to the target masses A. So you see, you have a polynomial equation in U and V, but it's very simple if you look at it as an equation on U. And of course, you have the reversed equation, which would be V times K transpose U equal B. It's the same, but you change the role of U and V and A and B. So what is hard here is to solve the two equations at the same time, because you see U and V get mixed together in a nonlinear way. But if you do an iterative algorithm, you can say, okay, if you give me V, I can compute U very easily, simply by putting this guy on the left side. This is what I'm going to do. I'm going to do a step of I update U by dividing A by K times V, and then I'm going to update V by dividing B by K transpose times U. When I do this, I'll solve this equation, but of course I don't solve this equation, and the other way around. So of course it's not obvious, because it's an iterative algorithm. Will it converge? If it converges, it's good, we've solved the problem. But okay, it's a fixed point method. For it to converge, it should be contractant. It's not so clear. Actually, it's true, it's contractant. And the proof was done by Simcorn in 64, because this algorithm is much older. It was also introduced in the 30s. So it was introduced even before Kantorovich. But it's usually called Simcorn because he's the guy that proves the convergence of the algorithm. And it's also a very, very nice theorem. It was an algorithm and a beautiful theorem with a beautiful theory. And as you see, it's so simple. It's just two lines of Python code. So it's why we love it so much. The other reason why we love it so much, it's very simple also from the operator it uses, because division is pointwise division, it's O of n, it's trivial. But the only bottleneck is multiplication between a matrix and a vector. So it's n squared, which is good. I mean, n squared is better than n cubed, so it's quite efficient. But more than this, it can be implemented on a GPU, graphic processing unit, very efficient. The GPU are basically designed for this kind of operation. Also, it can be implemented in parallel by multiplying together lots of matrix time a vector using the matrix-matrix multiplication. And GPU are designed for this. So really, the game changer here is when you want to solve very, very large problem and also solve a lot of problems at the same time, a typical machine learning scenario. Okay? And there's a lot of tricks and implementation details that you can use to make this even faster. For instance, this is a Gibbs kernel, so it's an exponential kernel. And if you want to compute it on the computer, it's very large. So with my team, and in particular collaborator Jean Fédy and so on, they have developed codes to handle kernel computation efficiently. Okay. So it's quite it's both simple and efficient algorithm. So before going to machine learning, I'd like to point to several extensions that you can do that are trivial, very simple, but very important in practice. The first one is there's many situations where the data is not normalized. Maybe you have shape and they don't have the same volumes or area, so they don't have the same amount of mass, and you still like to transport them together. It raises the question of how do you transport together with creation and destruction of mass. And the way we've solved this problem with my co-author, in particular, it was the PhD thesis of Linnaeus Schiza, and it was also studied by several other teams at the same time, so several work proposing the same solution, is to somehow hybridize the geometry of optimal transport with the geometry of information. Where the optimal transport will take care of the transportation of mass, and geometry of information, typically Ellinger distance or Fischer-Rao, will take care of the creation and destruction of mass. And the optimization problem is surprisingly simple. It's basically just saying, instead of imposing that the first marginal P1 should be exactly equal to alpha, you would just penalize it using your favorite scissor divergence. For instance, the most simple one is, once again, the relative entropy. So you solve a slightly different problem where you penalize by some factor tau the optimization problem, optimal transport problem. When tau is infinity, you recover optimal transport. It's fairly easy to show. But also interestingly, when tau tends to zero, you recover the Fischer-Rao metric, which here is just the Ellinger distance. So you have this comparison between very different behavior. So I would start by the one on the right. The one on the right is optimal transport, where you want to transport two mixture of Gaussians. But I've played a trick. I've made this bump here a little bit bigger than this one, which is what happened in every situation. In all the situations locally, you don't have exactly the same amount of mass. And it's really a big problem for optimal transport because it needs to satisfy the conservation of mass. So you need to actually split this bump in two, and you have this little soliton that will travel all the way. So it's really the typical example where optimal transport is not regular. So where you cannot apply regularity theory because the data is not at all what optimal transport like. But it's what happened in real life. Okay. So what you would do, you would simply penalize a bit and allow for the destruction of mass here, where this bump gets nicely mapped to this one, and at the same time, some mass gets destroyed. And here, it's the opposite. This bump gets mapped to this one, and a bit of mass is added, which happens in many situations, like in biology, in tumor growth model, or cells evolution. It's really typical scenario where you don't want to use optimal transport, you don't want to use Ellinger, you want to use some hybridization between the two. Because, of course, Ellinger, there's no transportation. So it's not also what you want. It's going to be a classical mixture, because Ellinger is basically giving you access only to vertical displacement. So there is a parameter. Okay, it's bad. You have an extra parameter. But I think it's a nice price to pay to have access to the best of both worlds. And in practice, for machine learning, it's super important. Okay. And the good news also, and I won't go into the details, is you can apply syncon algorithm. It's exactly the same. You just raise to some power the iteration. So it's one line of code. The same algorithm can solve everything. It's quite nice. All right. So another example of extension, and there is many more. I'm just selecting two typical extension that fits really well into this syncorn idea. It's the idea of computing Wasserstein-Barycenter, which was introduced by Guillaume Carlier and Martial Aguet, who said, okay, you can try to compute Fréchet-Barycenter of distribution by minimizing a weighted sum of Wasserstein distance. And the very nice thing is that the Wasserstein distance is a convex function. Wasserstein is convex of both its inputs. It's really nice. I mean, who would believe that you could have such a rich geometry while still being convex, I guess? I mean, at first, I was surprised, and it's really nice. So it means these guys, it's a Fréchet mean, but it's also a convex problem. So you can speak about global optimality, efficient algorithm, and new theory. And these two guys, they basically extend all the theory of Brognier to the Barycenter case. Okay. So you have several inputs, and you want to compute someone in the middle. Okay? Now, an example of application would be like computing averaging of shapes, but it's a very dumb averaging of shapes. It's just basically you treat your shape as particles, and they would fuse together. So I would say more realistic application would be averaging of high-dimensional data, typically for machine learning or for clustering. Okay, it's just an abstract tool that you might want to use as in your toolbox. And once again, the nice news is a single algorithm extends also to these settings. But instead of having just two distributions, you have several. So you typically need to run in parallel several single algorithms. It's as simple as this. And then don't go into the details, but it's basically an extension of the previous theory of this Schrödinger method. What I would like to spend a bit more time on is to discuss what happened in high dimension. What can you do with this idea of SimCorn when the dimension is very large and you want to solve a data fitting problem in high dimension? And the answer is that first it looks very bad. And probably the first thing to look at is it a meaningful way to compare shapes or distribution? And the answer is no. Why? Because you have added this entropy, which is a strictly positive number. So it's not anymore a distance. It's even worse than this. It doesn't satisfy that the cost of this static Schrödinger problem between two distributions is zero. It's going to be strictly positive because of the entropy. So if you do shape matching or even like just very simple point cloud matching with this, you want to look for the distribution which is the closest to beta. Normally the solution should be alpha equal beta. But as epsilon increases, you have a bias, an inward bias, because of this extra temperature. And it gets worse and worse as epsilon goes to infinity. And at the end of the spectrum, you get a single point. So the target is going, I mean, the match is going to shrink to the average. So it's very bad. You have a very nasty bias. So you need to remove this bias. And maybe the most naive or dumb idea is to remove directly the diagonal, which was actually, you can find it. It's kind of a polarization formula for those who knows about kernel methods. But you can also find it in a paper with Marco, who used this formula for statistical tests, not for shape matching. And the idea is you simply subtract one half of the interaction between alpha and itself, which is non-zero, and one half of the interaction of beta with itself. So now, of course, if you take alpha equal beta, it's going to be zero. But you have negative value, so maybe it's even worse. Maybe things will blow and it will go to minus infinity, who knows. So what we did with my student Aude is we just tried on our computer, and to our surprise, it was working very nicely. It was always positive. It was like a distance. And when I look at this formula, it looked a bit weird. So I said, okay, maybe there is some nice mathematics to do, and we start trying to study this formula, which was really motivated by purely heuristic reasoning. But at the end, it was, as you will see, having very nice theory. The first thing we did is to look at the asymptotics to see what's happening in the low and the high temperature limit. In the low temperature limit, you recover optimal transport, which is not surprising. Also, it's not so simple to prove. And it was studied by several authors, in particular Christian Léonard, who studied in detail the Schrödinger problem. So at the first end of the spectrum, you get like classical optimal transport theory. But what's even more interesting is as epsilon goes to infinity, as I told you, the optimal transport becomes total independence, becomes the product of the input. So it becomes an inner product, actually, a Hilbertian inner product. So because of this polarization formula, what you retrieve when epsilon goes to infinity, it's what is called a kernel norm. Sometimes it's called a kernel norm. In statistics, it's called maximum mean discrepancies, which has several names, for the same object, which is just classical Euclidean norm. What I mean by classical Euclidean norm, how do you build an Euclidean norm over distribution? Well, you need to integrate a kernel. So how do you do this? You compute the difference alpha minus beta, because it's a norm, and then you integrate twice this difference against the kernel. So you compute the energy of interaction. For those who do physics, it's the energy you'll find everywhere in physics. Like Coulomb energy or electromagnetical energy. So everything is exactly having this kind of double integral energy. Here, what is a bit surprising is the kernel you need to integrate is minus the distance to the power p, which might look a bit weird because you have this minus sign. So how could it be positive? But in fact, don't forget that this is the difference between two measures. So this guy is actually something that is both positive and negative. So is it true that this guy is positive? And the answer is yes, in several cases. A typical, I would say, iconic case, and it's a very nice kernel, is the case on the Euclidean space. On the Euclidean case, if you take the distance to the power p, which I would say is the most simple case for optimal transport, and you take p strictly between 0 and 2, this guy is actually positive, and it's a norm. It's a very famous norm, actually. It has several names. It's called Cramer norm. It's also called energy distance in statistics. There is a Wikipedia page about this. And I think it's a great kernel. People should use it. It's better than, in high dimension, it's much better than the Gaussian kernel. Because it's a scale-free kernel, there is no scale. It's totally global kernel. It's very stable. And for those who do, would say, PDEs, actually, here you can recover, you can see, actually, for those who knows, it's going to be the green solution of a Laplacian, if you want. So in fact, this guy is actually a Sobolev norm. It's a Sobolev norm of negative index. Okay. For those who don't know about Sobolev, no worry, but just you recover a classical Sobolev space. So epsilon, the temperature, is a way to interpolate between a totally non-flat space of optimal transport. Because except in dimension 1, in dimension 2 and higher, optimal transport is not at all flat, it's not Euclidean. And at the end of the spectrum, you get a totally flat space, totally flat, totally Euclidean, you just compute the difference. So it's totally opposite behavior. And at the both end of the spectrum, they metrize the convergence in law. So it's two philosophy of life to control the same topology. Of course, we are in infinite dimension, so you have the same topology, but very different behavior. So do you prefer optimal transport? Do you prefer kernels? It's probably a fight that will never end. I guess, depending on the application, sometimes it's better to emphasize on the transport, sometimes rather emphasize on interaction. And here with epsilon, you can play between the two. Okay? What is reassuring is, for any epsilon, actually, we proved that it's also metrizing the convergence in law. It's a theorem we proved with several co-authors recently. If the kernel is positive, and a typical example is the Gaussian kernel, for instance, for an Euclidean space, it's going to be true that this quantity is positive. Although there are negative signs, the total quantity is always positive. And it defines the same topology. So you are on the safe side if you want. You can use it to do shape matching. It will work because it has the same nice geometric behavior. And you can see this as a way to debias Sinkhorn algorithm. With Sinkhorn, you have a bias towards the inside. And with this negative sign, you would have something where the optimal solution would be alpha equal beta. And you can use it to do like training of neural nets or to do shape matching, which is what we do a lot. All right? So what should you prefer? I don't have a definitive answer to who's the best. There's no definitive answer. Let me just say why in high dimension you cannot do optimal transport. You should do something else, maybe what we propose or what you like more. It's because of sample complexity. The fact that in practice, in numerical application, you need to discretize your problems. And if you're in low dimension, well, it's easy. In 2D, you do like finite elements, okay? But in high dimension, it's not possible to do discretization. So, I mean, to do like finite elements and to have a careful approximation. So you need to look at what happens if instead of having to compare alpha and beta, you compare some discrete version with endpoints that are drawn, for instance, randomly, independently. The bad news is with optimal transport, it converges very slowly. The error you make scale like 1 over n to the power 1 over d. Which is not surprising because it's a typical error you make when you quantize points in high dimension. In high dimension, if you want to quantize something, you have to pay this price. And optimal transport is basically some kind of a bit more clever quantization method. So you pay the price of quantization, so in high dimension it's not possible. As a sharp contrast, if you want to compute kernels with samples, well, kernel is just basically a sum, it's just a double sum, so you pay the price of discretizing an integral with a sum, which is typically what you do in the Monte Carlo method, and everybody knows that, well, here you don't pay the price of dimension. You converge at rate 1 over square root of n. So you become independent of the dimension, which is a bit cheating because, of course, everything is hidden in the capital O, and the constant, they might depend on the dimension. So I'm not saying that the Monte Carlo method solves all the problems, but at least in terms of scaling, it's independent of the dimension. So you see something you cannot use, something that at least there is some hope. So what happened with this epsilon smoothing? Well, I told you that it's interpolated between the two, so it should come as no surprise that the rate you obtain is indeed interpolating between the two. Meaning that as epsilon is strictly positive, the rate becomes 1 over square root of n, but there's no free lunch. Of course, then the constant will depend on epsilon and will blow with epsilon. So it means that if you want to choose a super small epsilon to approximate optimal transport, this will not save you. And in fact, you can prove there are also lower bounds. So it's not possible to approximate optimal transport even between a cube in high dimension using just point sample. You need to do something a bit more. So if you want to play the game of, hey, let's choose epsilon as a function of m, trying to be clever, if you balance this error, of course, you would end up having the same rate. So once again, the take-home message is this is by no means a way to approximate optimal transport efficiently. It's just that if you believe in Schrödinger, if you think that Schrödinger is good for your problem with a fixed epsilon, maybe 0.1 or 0.5, then it converges fast. But now, of course, if at the same time you start decaying epsilon, well, it will blow. So it's not the end of the story. So of course, the good question is, what can I do with it? Would it solve my problem? Because this is just telling you that you can discretize, but will Sinkhorn algorithm work good for your problem? For now, there is no theory. So we do experiments, we try to see what is the epsilon, And what you observe, okay, of course, is that if you are in high dimension, you cannot take epsilon very small because you would pay a price. Okay. So it's just the start of the story, but it's reassuring to see that you gain in terms of this kind of sample complexity. All right, so now let's move to this kind of more, I would say, how would you say, less mathematical or more experimental application that is very trendy, where there's no theory. It's not clear that optimal transport will change anything, but at least it's nicely fit into the picture, and it's definitely a very high dimensional problem. So there's a lot of open problem for mathematicians, I guess, that should try to study these very challenging and complex problems. So what is the general task? It's the same as before, trying to do density fitting. In high dimension, you want to approximate point cloud with a continuous distribution. So the first step that any reasonable statistician would do is to set up a maximum likelihood problem. Okay, you say, okay, my model, I would assume, and this is a very strong assumption, that they have a joint density. They have a density with respect to some fixed reference measure, typically a Gaussian. Here, you would take dx to be the Lebesgue measure, for instance. Doesn't really matter which dx you use. And then you make the hypothesis that your data is drawn independently at random with the same distribution, and you maximize the likelihood, which can be the product of the density evaluated at the point. But as any good optimizer, you would prefer minimizing the sum, so you would take minus the log of the product, and you would have to minimize minus the sum of the log of the density. Okay. Here we are on the safe side. And a way to see this is that as the number of samples of beta grows, this guy would become an integral, and you can view this maximum likelihood as doing like geometry of information fitting, where you would minimize the relative entropy between the two. So this is where you get very nice estimators, for instance, for Gaussian or for exponential models. What is the problem you have with deep learning? The problem with deep learning is the typical setup that they will consider is what they often call generative models, where they say, okay, let's forget about trying to compute rho theta, it's probably too complicated. Let's just design an algorithm using deep learning or a deep net that would generate for me samples. And how would that do? I mean, it's the most naive way is to say, I would start drawing points at random in a cube, for instance, in low dimension, and then I will use my deep net to send it to a high dimensional space. So you see the surface you get, the density you get, is now modeled implicitly as a push forward or as an image measure of a very simple measure in low dimensions to a very complicated function. And what is the trouble with it is that as you would move theta, this surface will change, so it will be very singular. And you cannot pick Lebesgue measure or any reference measure to obtain something that would have a density for all possible choice of the parameter. So it's because you map to a high dimensional space, you get measures that are very nasty. So this quantity would have no meaning. Basically, it would be zero everywhere. So you would have something that is plus infinity, and the MLE would typically not be defined. Which means you need to switch of topology. Instead of computing something that tries to minimize somehow for the strong topology, you need to do something that is compatible with the convergence law, with this kind of elastic matching of points. So, and many people have proposed this. Of course, we are not the one that proposed this idea of introducing Wasserstein estimator or kernel estimator. And of course, these are just two extreme cases. And by playing on epsilon, you can interpolate between a minimum Wasserstein estimation, and epsilon goes to plus infinity, a minimum kernel estimation. So we call this like syncorn estimator, if you want, which estimates the parameter theta by minimizing some function computing using syncorn algorithm. So it's conceptually simple, but of course, as you might guess, it's very hard to solve numerically. But as I would say, as any problem involving deep nets, there is like a big gap between the equation and how do you solve it in practice. So let me try to go a bit more in why it's hard and why it's hard to say anything, actually. And it's a nice avenue for mathematicians. First of all, I would say it's a fairly interesting usage of deep learning, of deep generative models, because most people that would use deep nets efficiently and successfully up to a few years now, we are using deep net in a supervised way, where they use a deep net to map, for instance, an image to a low-dimensional representation of the data, a feature representation. The most extreme case would be, given my image, give me, you have some class, is it a cat, is it a dog, and so on. So you have maybe 100 and 1,000 representation vectors. So in a supervised learning way, deep net are used to reduce the dimension, if you want. But here, for generative purposes, it's exactly the opposite. You start by a low-dimensional latent vector that would be random, and then you send it to a high-dimensional space. And it's a very nice idea that was proposed quite recently, actually, a few years ago, where you'd simply run the network backward. Okay, so it's a really innovative usage of deep learning to rather generate data instead of summarizing data, if you want. So it looks simple, once again, but it's hard because what you want to do is, given random data that you would map to a high-dimensional space, you'd like to optimize the weights. Typically, in a convolutional weight, it would be convolution kernel, in order to have the best possible fit with the input. Okay? So just to be a bit more scary, why is it complicated in terms of optimization, just to draw the computational pipeline. So the optimization problem is horrible, because you want to compare a continuous distribution, if you want, to a discrete distribution that might have like millions of points. So it's not even clear how you solve this. So how people do this in practice, they do stochastic optimization. So they simply replace alpha and beta by drawing a few samples at random and replacing at each iteration their very hard problem by simpler one. So, and this is very questionable because in this type of problem where this is above a certain distance, it's not clear, I mean, it's even not true that you can apply the theory of stochastic optimization, but you still do this. And then it comes to the question of how do you actually compute the gradient of this function. And just to be a bit scary, what is this function? It takes random point as input, it uses the deep nets, then it computes the famous Gibbs kernel, which is basically depending on the distance between your random generated points and the inputs, and it's a fairly large matrix. And then you run syncorn, which itself is like another deep net, if you want, because you use the Gibbs kernel, and you use typically a nonlinear function, which is just 1 over x. So it's running also another set of layers. And you want to compute the derivative of this function with respect to what? To the weights of your deep nets. So it looks a bit scary. And how do you do this in practice? How people do this in deep learning? Well, they can do this because of a very nice theorem, the theorem of automatic differentiation. And the question is like this, is given some kind of ugly function you have computed on your computer that takes capital K operation, what is the complexity of computing its derivative? I think it's the most fundamental question one of the most fundamental questions of optimization. Because you start by a function from Rn to N to R, and the gradient, it looks more complicated because it's Rn to Rn. And what you should not do, but nobody would do this, I guess, is to compute finite differences. Because finite differences would require you to compute all directional derivatives. So if you are in dimension n, and deep learning n is of the order of the million, this would cost an extra cost of 1 million times your algorithm. So if you were to use finite differences, nobody would be doing modern machine learning. Because modern machine learning is about training very large models. So the reason why I would say fundamentally it's possible, it's because of this theorem that was proved by this guy in the 70s, but there's many occurrences of this idea even before, is a fundamental theorem of reverse mode of automatic differentiation, and that the complexity of computing the gradient is the same as the complexity of computing the function. And it's not only a theorem, it comes with an algorithm which is called reverse mode automatic differentiation, which is one of the most beautiful algorithms. It was reused a lot, of course, for classical feed-forward architecture. It's often called backpropagation, but it works with any code, because any code can be mapped through basically a graph that you can backpropagate. Okay, so you can use it for anything, and in practice people now, they would use PyTorch or TensorFlow, combined with some kind of efficient library to implement your deep nets and the kernels, which in practice it's fairly efficient. So it's really a game changer, the fact that you can apply these techniques to train complicated models with complicated loss, like syncorn, probably other ones. All right, so I think it's a good point. But okay, what can you say in theory? It's more difficult. So on very simple data sets, things are well under control. And a typical example of a simple data set is the MNIST data set, which is simply small images, like I guess it's 32 times 32, or maybe 64 times 64. Of black and white images, so things work great, use optimal transport with Euclidean distance, and you generate new digit that looks good. But for this, you don't need deep net, actually. It's a too simple data set. Now, if you come to more complicated data, like this is small images of celebrities, it's not clear at all what to do. And I would say why it's not clear, it's because they don't tell you what distance you should use between your images. And if you use Euclidean distance between images to compare them, it's a total disaster. So the next revolution, so the first revolution is this idea of generative network. The other revolution was led by this guy, Ian Goodfellow, who introduced this idea of generative network, which I will not describe, but it's this idea that you would train two networks at the same time, one to generate and another classical network to discriminate. And you can view this, if you think about optimal transport, as the second network is actually computing or trying to create the distance itself. You learn at the same time the generative model and the distance to discover it. And the way you compute it is unfortunately not so nice. It's by maximizing the discrepancy by trying to find an adversarial network that tries to discriminate, as a policeman, if you want, that want to discriminate the true data from the fake data. So computing the worst possible distance to make them as apart as possible. And then you have a min-max problem, so a saddle point problem, and things become even more complicated because, as you know, doing game theory is much more complicated than just doing classical optimization, and it's very non-convex. So it's really, really hard to understand. But it gives surprisingly, and I would say amazingly, good results. This is what we have on our small computer, so with a single GPU, so we can only train small images. But people in companies, especially at NVIDIA and more other companies like Google and so on, they have like huge farms of GPUs that can train a huge network on very high resolution images. And just to show some recent results, I mean, this is 1 year old, so now they have even more, much better results. It's trained on high resolution faces, but what you see here have been generated by NVIDIA, and it's virtual faces, if you want. They are not in the database. And what is even nicer is they display this video by doing just a linear interpolation on the latent space, and then mapping this linear interpolation to some kind of curve, a curve of fake images on this manifold, if you want, of faces that is learned. And it gives, also it's not perfect, there is a few glitches, but it's surprisingly good interpolation. It's not at all linear. It warps the face, it creates the air, the eyes, and so on. And nobody understands why. And it's not because of optimal transport. It's because of the deep net that does something very complicated. But it, of course, it raises a lot of questions and a lot of mathematics to do. I'd like to conclude, maybe, on this, to try to give you a few take-home messages. The first one, and this is why I've put these faces, but there is much more to put, is of course there is a long tradition, a long history of, I would say, mathematical advances in optimal transport. I've mentioned Monge and Kantorovich, but probably and Danzig, which are the founding fathers. But more recently in mathematics, there is a lot of huge breakthroughs that were driven, among others, by results from Yann Brunier, who connected this to PDEs, Robert McCann, Otto, and so on. And more recently, Figali, with a student of Villani that studied the regularity theory of optimal transport, which somehow have convinced you that it's kind of not what happens in data science. It's a huge gap between this very, very complicated geometric theory of PDE and what you have in practice, which is fairly noisy, fairly difficult. And one great question is how can you use these tools, these results, in order to have impact on data science to design new loss functions that could be used in practice, typically have a new way or alternative way to define comparison of results. But the problem is, okay, for instance, for generative model, which is a typical scenario where optimal transport could be used, there is no clear, not even mentioning theory, but not clear understanding of what is a good generative model, what quality measure do you want to use? Do you want to use the Wasserstein distance? Well, probably not, because I've told you that in high dimension, you cannot compute it. So it's fairly open now, so people are using ad hoc measure of quality. I didn't mention this, but there are a lot of measure of quality of generative model, but who's the one you should use? It's fairly not understood. And it also raised a lot of interesting questions that are not really well answered. The big one, and one of the biggest one, is how do you do metric learning? So in optimal transport, well, as in other fields, but it works great if you have a good metrics, but in some cases, I mean, in many cases, nobody knows what is a good metric. So of course it's nice to try to do adversarial training, but then you enter game theory and so on. So it's quite not so simple to understand this, but it's a very hot topic of research, and probably even more far-reaching or complicated generalization is how do you go beyond comparing measures? One typical question is, okay, there's many data sets that don't live in the same space. For instance, if you do natural language processing, you might have some text in French, some text in English, you might have several languages, so they all live in their respective metric space. How do you do this? It turns out that there is a very nice theory that extends optimal transport to the case where the data don't live in the same space, which is kind of often called Gromov theory or Gromov-Wasserstein. The problem is now it doesn't anymore correspond to a linear problem. It's going to be a quadratic problem. because you need to match together pairs of points, which is known to be NP-hard. So it opens the door to how do you address NP-hard problem approximately? Can you assert some kind of, probably not global optimality, but at least say something about this? And how do you apply this to do generative models and more complicated stuff on different metric spaces? Okay, so I will stop here and thanks for your attention.